While you're in the first 5 seconds of the video, go ahead, like and subscribe. All right, the class that we're going to go over today is titled Righteous Before God. Righteous Before God. So before we go to the first scripture, go to the, pull up that definition of righteous.
Righteous, just according to the divine law, applied to persons. It denotes one who is holy in heart and observant of the divine commands in practice as a righteous man. Applied to things, it denotes consonant to the divine will or to justice as a righteous act. It is used chiefly in theology and applied to God, to his testimonies, and to his saints.
So from this definition, get Ezekiel 18, I think it's 18 and 5. That's not on my notes, but just according to the divine law, it denotes to one who is holy in heart and observant of the divine commands and practice. We know that to mean that we are observant to keeping the God's commandments. That's what it means to be righteous before God. Read that is in Ezekiel.
Yep. Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 5. But if a man be just and do that which is lawful and right, jump down verse 9. Verse 9, have walked in my statutes and have kept my judgments to deal truly, he is just. He shall surely live, saith the Lord God.
So, when you're just, you're keeping the commandments. It's simple, in simplest terms, when you're just, when you're righteous, you're keeping God's commandments. Go to Luke chapter 1 and verse 5. Because as we are repentant Israelites, we're supposed to be righteous before God. That's what we say, especially when you change your name, and they say, Mr. Israel, you're supposed to be an example of being righteous before God. Read that.
Luke chapter 1 and verse 5. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abiah, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth.
Uh-huh.
And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinance of the Lord, blameless.
So this is more clear proof. When you say you're righteous, when you say you're an Israelite, you're righteous before God, you're walking in his commandments. When you're walking in his commandments, that's when you're righteous before God. When you're actually doing what the commandments say, you're studying and you're applying. Go to Romans chapter 4 and verse 1.
Romans chapter 4 and verse 1. What shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, have found? Verse 2. For if Abraham were justified by works, he have whereof to glory, but not before God. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness.
So Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So how did Abraham show that he believed God? How did Abraham show that he believed God? Go to Genesis chapter 15. So it says Abraham was justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Read that.
Genesis chapter 15 and verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham in a vision, saying, fear not, Abraham, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And Abraham said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir.
So Abraham was well, well stricken in age, and he had no children. He had him and his wife Sarah had no children out of his loins from her womb. Read.
Verse 4. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir.
So the Most High God told him that, no, this Eliezer of Damascus is not going to be your heir. Your heir is going to come out of your loins. You're going to have a son. Read.
Verse 5. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be.
Read.
And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness.
So Abraham believed in the Most High, believed the promise that the Most High God gave him, and he was accounted to him for righteous. So from there you see, okay, I believe, because in modern day Christianity, they always saying, I believe. But then the minute you bring out a commandment, oh, no, we ain't got to do that. Oh, no, I can't do that. But then they turn around and say, oh, I could do all things through Christ that strengthens me. But they say they believe, but they don't keep the commandments. So he believed God. He believed in the Lord, and he counted to him for righteousness. Jump over to 18 and 14.
Genesis chapter 18 and verse.
Start up at 9.
Genesis chapter 18 and verse 9. And they said unto him, where is Sarah thy wife? And he said, behold, in the tent. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son.
So we all know what happens for, a husband and a wife to have a son. For an angel to tell him, I'm going to return according to the time of life, and you're going to have a son, that means Abraham, he believed God, and he laid with his wife, and she became pregnant. Read.
And Sarah heard it in the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women.
So even though Sarah was well beyond menopause, she was well beyond the age where she could have children, Abraham still believed that he was going to be able to lay with his wife and get her pregnant and have a son, because God told it to him. That was his action that showed that he believed in God. Read.
Verse 12. Therefore Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am waxing old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also?
Jump to verse 14.
Verse 14. Is it anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son.
So we see Abraham took action on the promise that he was given from the Most High. The Most High told him he was going to have a son, and he took action, and he had a son. So we see that that's how Abraham was accounted righteous before God. Go to Sirach chapter 32 and 24. Sirach chapter 32 and verse 24.
Ecclesiasticus chapter 32 and verse 24. He that believeth in the Lord taketh heed to the commandment.
So when you say you believe in the Lord, you have to take heed to the commandment. What does it mean to take heed to the commandment? When you take heed to the commandment, you are very careful and cautious not to do something that go against the commandments. Before you make a move, you think, you know what, is this going to be going against God's laws? Am I going to be breaking the commandments before I do this? Before I go and open my mouth, am I slandering my brother or my sister? Before I go take this, just for example, say, before I go take this bag of chip off the shelf and walk out the door, is that what God instructed me to do? Is that the commandments, or am I breaking the commandments? You're going to take caution not to break the commandments, because you know, when you take heed to the commandments, you know that there's a penalty behind you breaking the commandments. You know that the wages of sin is death. You know, even though I might not get judgment right now, I could very well walk out this store, be waiting on the bus, and the bus jumped the curb. you take heed not to break the commandment. That's when it say you take heed. Read it again.
He that believeth in the Lord taketh heed to the commandment.
Uh-huh.
And he that trusteth in him shall fare never the worse.
So when you take heed to the commandment, you take caution not to break it. You take caution not to break the commandments. You take caution to study the commandments so you know what you can and can't do. And do you make it your point and your aim to not go against the commandment? You take caution, and then you read the last part again.
And he that trusteth in him shall fare never the worse.
And when you trust, when you trust in the Most High God, he going to make things work. Even if you might lose your job. You might lose your house. You might lose your car. You know, bad things may happen, but you know, hey, Psalms 37 and 25. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging bread. You know that the Most High, because you uphold God's commandments, you know that the Most High God got your back. You understand that, hey, these material things, I ain't going to take with me when I die. So you're not attached to them. Not saying that we're not going to have material things, but you're not attached to them to the point where you're going to break God's commandments just to keep your material things. Go from there, go to Proverbs 12 and verse 15.
Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 15. The way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise.
So it says the way of a fool is right in his own eyes. You a fool. We are very foolish if we think that we can go and do things our way, how we think they should be done, even when we're doing something against the commandments. Even when we blatantly break God's commandments, we blatantly break the Sabbath and make statements, well, I'm keeping some aspects of the Sabbath. I'm keeping a little bit of aspects of the Sabbath. Well, I ain't breaking it all the way. That's the thought of a fool. That's the words of a foolish man. That's the words of a foolish woman. Because in your mind, that's what the scriptures talk about when they say our righteousness is as filthy rags. It's not talking about the commandments as many of us, if you came out of Christianity, that's one of the favorites that they pull. To say that we can't be righteous, we can't keep the commandments because our righteousness is filthy rags. No, when we keeping the commandments, we doing what God defines as righteous. That's how we define righteous before God. Read it again.
The way of a fool is right in his own eyes.
You have when you a fool takes no regard, has no fear of God when it comes to God's laws. Read.
But he that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise.
He that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise. Meaning you read, you study, you get counsel from the leadership, you get counsel from those that senior to you, and they give you the scriptures and you follow. You actually do what they instructed you to do because it's according to the commandments.
I got a precept. Go ahead. There. Give me that precept in Proverbs 14 and 12. Saying the same thing. This for those who may not have got that scripture. Watch this.
Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 12. There is a way which seemeth right unto a man.
A fool, right? It's a way that seemed right to a fool. Read.
But the end thereof are the ways of death.
But in the end, it's the ways of death. Like you had made a statement about keeping part of the, what would you say?
Aspects of the law. Some certain aspects of the law.
That don't even make sense, right? How you going to keep an aspect of the law? No, the law is the law, right? Read that one more time.
There is a way which seemeth right unto a man,
uh-huh,
but the end thereof are the ways of death.
The end thereof is the ways of death. Now, give me that scripture. I believe it's in Matthew. It talks about if you break the least law. Watch this right here. Now, here's an example. Sabbath, Friday sundown to Saturday sundown. But some come up where you have to go to, let's say, a funeral, right? Or graduation on a Sabbath, okay? You decide in your own mind, I think I'm gonna go to the graduation. I've been going to the Sabbath for years. I'm gonna go to this graduation. I've been going to school for years. I'm gonna go to my graduation. But you're not thinking. You didn't get counsel. And if you did get counsel, you didn't listen. Because it's a graduation, meaning you already passed. You got your degree. Read what you got.
Matthew chapter 5 and verse 19. Mm-hmm. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments.
These what commandments?
These least commandments.
So now you're in a position where you're looking at the Sabbath as a least commandment because now you want to go to your graduation. Read.
And shall teach man so.
And you teach a man to do that is okay. Oh, well, he did it. So my graduation coming up, I'm going to do the same thing. Read.
He shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven.
Meaning you're not going to make it. You're not going to make it. One more scripture. Give me the scripture that talks about when you gain the whole world but lose a soul. You going to school, you putting all them bricks in school. Why? Because you want to be this successful whatever. Business owner, doctor, lawyer, whatever, right? But watch this. You doing all that for what? Is it for the filthy lucre? Is it for the fame? What is it for? Because what is our focus here? To get the kingdom. Watch this. You got that scripture? Matthew 16.
Yeah, that's it.
So be very mindful. There's no such thing as I'm keeping some aspect of the law. That's like saying, well, we married, but that's the right thing to do, but we just ain't got no paperwork. I'm keeping some aspect of the law. That don't make no sense. You done missed the sin. Read what you got.
Matthew chapter 16, verse 26.
Uh-huh.
For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world?
So you don't went to school, you don't spent 6-7 years in school, got your degree, now it's time to graduate, and the graduation happened to land on the Sabbath. Read.
If he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul.
You did all that schooling for nothing. Now you finna die. Right there in your office. That's all I got.
And the diploma gonna burn.
Yeah.
But that's when we come into this truth, of course it's gonna be ups and downs, so to say. You may slip up here and there, but the thing is, your mindset has to be always striving to get better and do better in its truth. Meaning your understanding grows and your ability to apply grows. Meaning when them temptations come, your spirit is stronger to apply the commandments no matter how hard it seems to be. Even if it feel like you're going to burst if you don't fall into that sin, you have to apply the commandments. And that's as you grow in the truth, as you gain experience in the truth, your spirit's supposed to get stronger to resist the temptation. The temptation always going to come. It's always going to be some type of trial that come our way, that come your way to try to get you to falter away from the commandments. It's up to you to make sure you studying, praying, and applying so that when those temptations come, you ready. You didn't load your spiritual weapon up so when that temptation come, you ready to apply. The first thing that pop in your mind is, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery. And then you actually, it don't just pop in your mind, you be like, well, maybe that was just a thought. No, you think it. It come to your mind. That's the Most High bringing that scripture to your mind so that you can apply it. Not so you can brush it off and be like, "Oh, maybe that was just a suggestion," and then you still go and fall into the sin. No, that scripture come into your mind so that you can apply it.
Watch this. Go to Hebrews 10 and 26, because you've been laboring in this truth for quite some time. Like you said, when some occur with this temptation, the precepts supposed to pop in your mind. And it ain't for you to wrestle with the precept. You don't wrestle with the precept. The precept is there to help you out. That's like in the Bible, it talks about setting a scourge in your mind, right? Read what you got.
Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 26.
Uh-huh.
For if we sin willfully.
If we sin willfully, knowing that, well, you know, it is the Sabbath, but it's my graduation. Read.
For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth.
Now, after you receive the knowledge of the truth, you sin in after you knew the Bible. You know the Bible, you learn the Bible, then you decide to sin. That's called willful sin. Read it again from the top.
For if we sin willfully,
uh-huh.
after that we have received the knowledge of the truth.
After receiving this knowledge, this truth, read.
There remaineth no more sacrifice for sin.
Ain't no more begging. Ain't no more begging and pleading. It's over with for you now. Because now you're thinking in your mind, well, you know what? I got the Day of Atonement. The Lord can kill you before the Day of Atonement approach. You could drop dead before the Day of Atonement. On the Day of Atonement. Remember we had a brother like that? He didn't drop well. He did. He spiritually did. This brother thought that, you know what? I'm going to commit this act because the Day of Atonement is approaching. I'm gonna be straight. He got counsel. Don't do it, brother. Brother, don't do it. Brother, in his mind, like a fool, you know what I'm talking about? That brother, after learning the truth, willfully sinned. Not only he's spiritually dead, but he's way worse than he was before he came in, a cokehead. He was an army vet. Left that, went back to go please a woman, and he thought that the Day of Atonement is approaching, I'm going to be cool. The Lord jacked him up. Last scripture, just to prove what happens when you do that, when you do willful sin. Is that 2 Peter 2 and 20? Watch this. Be very mindful, brothers and sisters. Do not play with these scriptures. There is a God.
2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 20.
Uh-huh.
For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world.
So after you have escaped the pollutions of the world, the drama, the gangbanging, the life of prostitution, the addictions, read.
Through the knowledge of the Lord.
Through the Bible, the knowledge of the Bible, read.
And Savior Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
They are again entangled therein.
And once you start to go back into the world, get entangled into the same things that you escaped from, read.
And overcome.
Uh-huh.
The latter end is worse with them than the beginning.
Yeah, you're going to be worse off than you ever was before. Was that it on that?
Nope.
Read.
For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness.
Hey, the Bible letting us know that you was better off not even stopping listening to the prophets. You was better off just covering your ears when they was preaching. You was better off not even knowing this truth than what?
Then after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them.
That's the worst thing you can ever do. Judas the Iscariot did that. The Lord told him, man, you might as well just die a slow death. Kill yourself. Jump in the ocean with a millstone around your neck. That's the meaning that you finna die a painful death after knowing the Bible and then willful sin. Is that it?
No.
Read.
But it had happened unto them according to the true proverb.
That's a true proverb, meaning a wise saying. This really happens. Read.
The dog is turned to his own vomit.
What the Lord call him?
The dog is turned to his own vomit again.
The dog has returned to his own vomit again. And that's in the book of Proverbs, by the way. Was that it? All right.
So it's very important that as we are repenting, we have to, just like John the Baptist said, we got to bear fruits worthy of repentance. We can't be living, saying one thing, but doing another. And then dealing with being righteous before God, we're going to deal with some of the common sins that Israel deal with coming out of the world and coming into this truth. One of those things is lying. Israel will lie. And it lie about things. Hey, man, where you at? I'm 15 minutes away and just rolled out the bed. Still got to get ready. Live 45 minutes away, but they 15 minutes away. Hey, man, I just turned on the block. Then you looking out and you don't see nobody. That's, pull up that definition. That's what Esau terms a white lie. And we so consumed, a lot of us are so consumed with it that we are, before we even hear clearly what the question was, we are already ready to answer. We already got a lie. What are we going to say? Hey, I'm on my way. No, you not. You just rolled out the bed. Read that.
White lie, a harmless or trivial lie.
There is no harmless or trivial lie. A lie is a lie. Read.
Especially one told to avoid hurting someone's feelings.
And a lot of times Israel do that because we don't want to hurt somebody's feelings. We don't want to tell them the truth, so we lie. That's a sin. The scriptures give Zechariah chapter 8 and verse 16. Because this is something that a lot of Israel do without effort. It's like a natural thing. They lie. And most of us, we had an uncle, a cousin, a best friend, somebody we grew up with. They lie so much that they believe they don't lie. And ain't nothing you can tell them. You can't tell them nothing. What they lying through their teeth. But anytime you tell them they lying, they all saying all type of swears and on this person and on my mama and all that, all this.
You got people that lie so much that when what comes out of their mouth, they try to make it believable to themselves and to others when they know it's a lie.
Yep.
It's crazy.
So read that.
Zechariah chapter 8, verse 16. These are the things that ye shall do. Speak ye every man truth to his neighbor. Execute the judgment of truth and peace in your gates. Verse 17.
Read it again.
These are the things that ye shall do. Speak ye every man the truth to his neighbor.
So as we are repenting, we know we Israel. And then just saying that, just think on that. The things that we've done, a lot of us came in 20, 30, 40. Think about the stuff that you was doing and you just seeing just looking at the Ten Commandments. The things that we was doing before we came into the truth, we deserve death. We don't deserve to be here. But yet we still would dabble in lying. We still dabble in those sins. Read that again.
Speak ye every man the truth to his neighbor.
Speak ye every man the truth to his neighbor. We shouldn't be going like, I use myself for example. When I was growing up, I was 19, 18, 19. My older brother was 4 years older than me. I was using his ID to get into the bar so I can go and have my fun. That's equivalent in this truth, you being in this truth, and you don't drink. We go somewhere, we don't drink, and it's a two drink minimum, and you go get a drink for your friend, and they'd already had their two drinks, so you go get a drink on behalf of them and say it's for you, but you don't drink. That's not of the spirit. That's not spiritual.
You know what's heavy about that situation? I'm not sure that's actually a real situation. That happens. Mm-hmm. You know what's heavy about that, though? Like, when you do that, both parties end up being judged.
Exactly.
Let's say he got those equivalent of six drinks for his brother. He riding back home with him, and they end up in an accident. Car looked like a pop can. They both dead.
Yeah.
Remember that video of the brother flew out the car, body, torso?
Yep. I'm
telling you. When you lie, you affect not just yourself, but the nation.
Yep.
A liar, when you lie, you affect the nation of Israel. That's why the way Moses dealt with liars a certain way. And the Lord said he did all in the book of Revelations, all liars will do what? What did he say?
They have their part in the lake of fire.
The lake of fire. You see what I'm saying? You affect the nation. Just to prove that, I'm in my last scripture, Ephesians 4 and 25. Watch what it say. Because I know a lot of y'all may be familiar with the situation where your parents was disciplining you at one point, or your sibling, and they may say something, you better not lie. And they tell a lie anyway. And they know you lying. And then they ask the sibling, did he do it? Yes or no? And you looking like you know if you tell the truth, he gonna get that butt whooped. But if you lie in your mind, he may not get the butt whooped, but he getting his butt whooped. And mess around, both of y'all get butt whooped. Just because you covered up for the lie. Watch this.
Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25.
Uh-huh.
Wherefore, putting away lying.
Putting away what?
Putting away lying.
Uh-huh.
Speak every man truth with his neighbor.
Here's the reason why.
For we are members one of another.
You see that? We got to put away lying. Why? Because we are members one of another. Remember when the brother lied about the Babylonian garment? Mm-hmm. The Lord's going to judge the whole nation for that thing. He's going to put the whole nation to death. They hit the council. Like, you know what? No.
Yep.
This is what we're going to do. Before the council was over with, he came forward. And the Lord killed his whole family and his animals and everything. So we got to be mindful. Lying affects the nation.
Yep, and then just that example, give Matthew chapter 18 and 6. We got to be mindful of that lying spirit, because especially those that been around, if you've been around and you've been laboring in this truth 3, 4, 5 years, and then you lying. This is what the scripture say about that. Read that.
Matthew chapter 18, verse 6. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me.
When you have a spirit like that, when you lie to get what you want, or lie to get what somebody else want, you offend the little ones. Let's see how the Most High feel about that. Read.
It were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck, and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea.
That's pretty much the Most High said, you're going to get put to death for offending one of my little ones. We gotta put that lying spirit away. There's no such thing as a white lie. A lie is you breaking the commandments. And the judgment for breaking the commandments is death. We got to put that spirit away from us. Get Acts chapter 5 and verse 1. Acts chapter 5, verse 1.
You want to read all the way to 10?
Yep, we're going to read all the way to 10.
Acts chapter 5 and verse 1. But a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession.
So Ananias and his wife Sapphira sold a possession. They sold something that was theirs. It was theirs. It may have been a house, some land, property, but it was theirs. They sold it for a price. Read.
And kept back part of the price.
And it says they kept back part of the price. When it say they kept back part of the price, that mean they lied. They sold it for $50,000 and they brought it a year. We sold it for $30,000. They kept back part of the price. They withheld. It's like, okay, what? It was yours. Right. Like, if you decided to sell it for $50,000 and bring $30,000 to give, that's your prerogative. What you lying for? Right. Read.
His wife also being privy to it. And
so they agreed together to do this. Read. Read.
And brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet.
Hey, we just sold this property for $30,000. Here, we bringing it to the church so it could be distributed amongst everybody. Lying through their teeth. Read.
But Peter said, Ananias, why have Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land?
And this is when the spirit was heavy on the apostles. The spirit let them know right away, he lying. And let's see what happened. Read.
While does it remain?
And then notice. Ananias and Sapphira thought they was coming and lying to men. But read that again, what he said.
But Peter said, Ananias, why have Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost?
You lied to the Holy Ghost. You lying to God. You not lying to men. We just being used by the Most High God. You lying to God. Read.
And to keep back part of the price of the land.
Read.
Whilst it remained. Was it not thine own?
When you had it in your possession before you sold it, it was yours. So if you decided to sell it for $50,000 and bring $30,000, that's what you chose to do. That's what the scriptures say. In, I think, 1 Corinthians 9. It say, whatever you purpose in your heart to give, give. So why? What's the purpose of lying? Read.
And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power?
It was in your power to choose what you wanted to give. Read.
Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God.
And that go back to that part of that definition. The definition say, especially one told to avoid hurting someone's feelings. Another reason why people lie is to avoid being punished, so to say. Or avoid, like in this case, they probably tried to hide because they probably thought in their mind, okay, if we tell them we sold it for 50, and we go take 30, they're going to ask for the other 20 when that wasn't the case. We get deceived in our mind. We can't let our mind deceive us into doing silly, foolish stuff. Read.
Verse 5, and Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost And great fear came on all them that heard these things.
So this is, we got to, these are the, this one, when we read that scripture in Sirach 32 and 24, this is the things that we got to think about. When it say take heed to the commandment, you got to take caution, because we don't know how, we don't know where the mercy stick at for each one of us. So we got to realize all our lives, the Most High been showing us mercy. The Most High been showing us mercy. All of us can't think of times, but a lot of us probably could think of times like, dang, I should have been dead. I should have died that day. The Most High been showing us mercy for longer than we knew that we was Israel. So we don't know that we go and tell that lie. We don't know if that's the day we go tell that lie, somebody pull out a gun and shoot us. We don't know if that's the end of the stick where the Most High, like, they got one more time, and that's it. And then we go lie, and now our life gone. We gotta be very mindful of that. We gotta be very mindful of that lion spirit, because that lion spirit, it goes very deep. It's deceitful. It goes into deceit. You be living a double life. You come in here on the Sabbath, but then you out sleeping with women, sleeping with men. You doing all type of things, evils outside of here. But then when you come in here, shalom, Most High in Christ bless. Hey, shalom, Most High in Christ bless. But then you living a lie.
Hey, real quick, look at verse 2 again, though. Because remember we said earlier that you affect the nation. Watch this. He affected his wife. Check this out.
Acts chapter 5 and verse 2. And kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it.
His wife was privy to the lie. She knew that he lied, right? So you got to be mindful. If you're in a situation, like for instance, brother had asked another brother standing right next to me, hey, how often do you call Officer Bezalel? Brother say, oh man, Officer Bezalel talk often. I looked at the brother like, bro, no, he don't. His brother just lied, like, bruh, no, I'm not going to just let you lie like that. I was privy, so no. But watch this, read it again.
And kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it.
Didn't even speak up. Now go carry on. As you read down, you're going to find out what's going to happen.
So jump to, because we already know that his wife was privy to it. She was privy to it, meaning she was in agreement to go on before the elders of the church and lie. Go to jump to verse
6 or 7?
No, because we were verse 5. Now jump to verse 9.
Acts 5 and verse 9. Then Peter said unto her, how is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord?
You agreed together to come before us like you dealing with regular men and lie in our face and think that the Most High wasn't going to expose you. That's what he's saying. The Most High exposed them and then judged them right there on the spot. Read.
Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door and shall carry thee out.
Read.
Verse 10. Then she fell down straightway at his feet and yielded up the ghost. And the young man came in and found her dead and carried her forth and buried her by her husband.
That's why we have to take heed how we move. We have to take heed to the commandment. We got to take caution to not break the commandment, because when we break the commandment, we are risking our lives right then and there. The Most High can take our life right there. And a lot of times we don't even think about that. We got to think about, it's always a cause and effect. We got to think about the effect of our actions. We got to think, okay, if I do this, this might happen. You know what? I ain't going to do that because this might happen. That's the thought process we got to have. Just think about it. Just think if our young men on the streets thought about that. They wouldn't lose their life. Because a lot of times when we know it'd be a lot of innocent bystanders, but a lot of the times when these young men get put to death is because something, it's because one, the life they living, and it's because of something they did. They might have killed somebody 2-3 weeks before, and then now it just came right back to them. We have to think of the cause and effect. Go ahead.
That's a heavy scenario because a lot of times, especially in this city, like when people die, police, they investigate. Have you seen anything?
Yeah.
They got this little law code called no snitching. First thing they say, nope, I ain't seen nothing. So do you know this guy? Nope. Yeah. Next drive by, they get killed.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? It's a cycle.
Yeah. That's heavy. Go from there, go to Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 9. This is also a line. This is also something Israel love to do.
Isaiah chapter 58.
If you got kids, they love to do it. They do it more than anybody. Read.
Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 9. Then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt cry, and he shall say, Here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, and the putting forth of the finger, and speaking vanity.
Israel love to point the finger. Israel will get caught in a lie. Well, what about him? He did this last week. We didn't see him do that last week. We talking to you right now. That's a lie. That's a diversion. You're trying to divert the attention off of you to somebody else so that you don't get in trouble, so that you don't get a judgment, so that you don't get corrected. So now it's, well, what about he been doing this all week? Like, but we right now, you just did it, and I seen you do it, and I'm correcting you. But what about them? Israel, that's we got to stop doing that. We got to learn to own up to our faults, our wrongs. We do wrong. We get corrected. You know what? You know what? You're right. I was wrong. Let me study some more, examine myself, and correct it. We got to put away from us that spirit to try to redirect the attention off of us, to try to amplify somebody else wrong or somebody else sin when we got caught red-handed in the midst of our sin. We can't roll in that spirit. So another thing, it goes hand in hand with I thought I put that scripture down. Go to Leviticus 19 and 11. Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 11.
Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 11. Ye shall not steal, neither deal falsely, neither lie one to another.
So you should not steal, neither deal falsely, nor lie one to another. This is all the same thing. You steal something, you lying. You taking something as if it's yours and it's not yours. Pull up that definition.
Steal, take another person's property without permission or legal right and without intending to return it.
So this is that pen you grabbed and didn't get back. Yeah, that pen you borrowed. I would say you borrowed a pen from somebody. Then you got home like, dang, I forgot to give them their pen back. Well, oh well, I'm going to keep it. That's stealing. That's the same as what we just read, the definition with lie, white lie. That's this is just one of them dollar pens. No, you give it back to them. It seems small, but it's still sin. It's still stealing because it's not yours. You see it, you hit it Sabbath, or you hit whatever, you borrow a pen, dang, I forgot to give them their pen back. You know what? Let me make myself a note so when I see them, I'm going to give them their pen back. That's the spirit we supposed to roll in. And that's a small thing, but that's what Israel do. It'd be the smallest things that we'll do, and they'd be like, and then you get caught, and they'd be like, it's just an automatic diversion and avoidance, like you did no wrong, and you never did nothing. No, just because it seems small to us, but to the Most High God, it speaks volume because it shows that you don't have integrity. You're not trustworthy. You're not honest.
Also faith, because scripture talks about he that is, have little in faith. How I go? If you trusted with a little, he'd be trusted with more.
Right.
So if somebody gave you borrow such as small as a pen.
Right.
Don't you know later on if you was hurting for like some, let's say, rent, they let you borrow some rent money. But if you couldn't get my damn pen back, you ain't finna get my, you know what I mean? What's that scripture?
He is faithful in a
faithful,
little.
Yeah,
faithful
yeah.
in a little.
Give me that real quick.
Faithful in much.
That's the same thing. So like you said, it's on a grand scale.
Yep.
You may look at it small like it was just a pen. I mean, he got a bunch of pens. When I looked over, he had a bunch of pens. But it was his pen though. Watch this.
Luke chapter 16, verse 10. And he that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much.
Right. You borrowed a pen from me. I expect you to give it back, but you, because I got a lot of them. Oh, man, you don't need that pen. Read.
And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much.
If you ain't get my pen back, bro, you ain't. Just like, here's an example. You rent a car from a car rental place, right? They qualify. They say that you're supposed to, when you bring it back, bring it back on full, you know, and pretty much bring it back in the same shape you got it. You bring it back with a quarter tank of gas, a dent, and a crack windshield. Do you think they finna rent you another car again? No, because you couldn't be trusted with the lease they gave you.
Yep. Go to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 28. And these are the things, and it's on a small scale, because if you do it on a small scale, you ain't no different from the brothers that band together and go rob a bank. The brothers that go take the ATM. And that's the thing, that's what Israel gotta understand, that yeah, we look at certain things as small. No, you ain't no different. You just ain't as bold to go and take an ATM. You just ain't as bold to go into rob a bank. But you still in that pen. You still in that your brother take go in his pocket. He at the register and go in his pocket and pull 20 out of dollar fall. You put your foot on it. That's stealing. That ain't a case where you walking down the street and it's just a dollar. You pick it up. No, you stealing. You seen your brother drop the dollar, and you like, well, I hope he don't notice he missed. He dropped it. That's stealing.
You know
that's, and it's small, but it's.
You mentioned something about stealing an ATM. That's crazy, right?
Right.
But it was a video when a man had stole an ATM. I think it was doing like Mike Brown when they rioted, and he waited on a bus stop with the ATM. The bus driver picked up
that.
A certain person on the bus stop, so this dude thought he was going to get on there with the ATM. The bus driver was like, no, I'm not. He closed the door on him. And he felt some type of way about it.
Yeah, the bus driver, he
know it's stolen. I'm not going to let you put an ATM on the bus. That was random. But that was just crazy. It just came to my mind.
But that's the spirit that Israel rolled in. We'll steal something. And then when you get caught, it's like, and I used to work in a retail store. And they had like they call them an LP officer that walks around the store. And they pretty much, they work with security, but they in plain clothes, they walk around the store and they watch people. And this is what they do. This is what they do. They see you when you walk in there, you suspicious. They see you go past some five times. And they see you when you steal it, and the person to go and they get caught. And then now they arguing and fighting. And it's like, well, you stole something. Like you got caught. So you stole something, you got caught. You just got to own up to it. You got to take responsibility for it and stop doing it. That's how we got to think. We can't throw an attitude, throw a tantrum because we got caught. No. You got caught, own up to it, and correct it. That's what the scriptures, because we all gonna make mistakes at times. But when you make that mistake and you get caught, you shouldn't get caught. You should confess it. But when and if you get caught, just say, hey, you know what? I messed up. I didn't confess it. I didn't get no counsel. You know what? I messed up. I'm going to do better. I'm going to get this right. That's the spirit we're supposed to roll in. That's a sincere spirit. A sincere spirit is going to, before they get caught, they're going to actually come and confess. They're going to come in, hey, you know what? I've been battling this. I'm doing this. Hey, I need help. Because the scriptures say, he that confesseth and forsaketh his sins shall have mercy. We can't walk around hiding under the pillow, hiding under the rug. No, eventually, the Most High is going to bring it out. And when the Most High bring things out, he makes something happen that ain't got nothing to do with you, but it expose you. And that's the take heed to the commandment. We all have to make sure we always got that thought in mind, that we taking heed to the commandments. Read that.
Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
So we have to have the mindset. This is us being righteous before God, that we not going to lie. We not going to steal. And another thing that people do that steal, well, I'm robbing the rich and giving to the poor. Like, no, that you still stealing. Well, it's Esau. No, the scriptures say, thou shalt not steal.
What about when they riot and somebody killed another black man in the street?
The scripture is
they're stealing.
Plain.
They're still stealing.
Well, everybody else doing it. That's to go back to Isaiah 58:9. Everybody else doing it. What you want me to do? No, apply the commandments because you're gonna get judged. You're not going. You can't go to when judgment day comes. You can't go before the Most High and say, "Well, what about Ezekiel? What about Judas?" No, the Most High gonna be like, "No, what about you? You did this, that, and the third. What about you?" The Most High ain't trying to hear about nobody else. You can only save yourself by your works, by what you did or didn't do. Read it again.
Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28. Let him that stole steal no more.
Us being righteous before God, we coming into this truth. Let him that stole steal no more. If you got that still, that thieving, conniving spirit, don't do it no more. Meditate on the scriptures. Meditate on scriptures about being content. About not stealing, about working. Read.
But rather let him labor.
What? Rather let him labor. Because a lot of people steal because they don't have. They steal something that they don't have because they want it instead of just going to get a job or going to schooling or whatever to make more money so that you can actually have the things that you want instead of trying to take it from somebody. Read.
Working with his hands. The thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
So then you will have, you would not only will you be able to take care of your own needs, you're going to be able to give to that other brother or that other sister that don't have so that they don't fall into that spirit of stealing. Go to Sirach chapter 37 and 25. Because this is, and even in that, you got that stealing, because that's what the spirit, because you feel like you don't have enough, so you'll go and steal.
What we got? Psalm chapter 37 and verse 25. I have been young and now am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken.
We gotta know that the Most High, no matter what state we in, the Most High is going to make sure we good. Sometimes we going to go through that rough trial we ain't got, but we got to rest assured that, read it again.
I have been young and now am old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread.
The Most High spoke through the prophet David. He said, I have been young and I'm old, and I never seen the righteous forsaken. We got to understand that we know we work a job, we got money to pay our bills, all of these things. But that's not what's going to get us into the kingdom. It's more than that. Not saying that it's not good to have the money and all that, but you can't trust in it. Because when you trust in money, when the Most High pull your car and strip you of it, you're going to fall out the truth. Because you're going to have a thought process of, well, I wasn't going through this before I came into the truth. Or, as we're dealing with the topic of stealing, the Most High going to strip you. Now he strip you of what you have. He bring that trial on you, and then now you're going, you're back to being a stick-up kid. Because you got, hey, I got a what they be saying? I got a get man. That's one of the things they be saying. We gotta make sure that we studying and standing in the scriptures constantly, so that we be righteous before God when that hard time come to us. Because we all gonna face that trial. We all gonna get to that point. Next and last thing, we gotta put away that gossiping spirit. And this ain't just the sisters. We could say it's mostly the sisters, but nah, the brothers be gossiping too. Brothers be whispering and all that other stuff. Read Sirach chapter 28, verse 13. Read 28, 13 through 17. Read it all the way through.
Sirach chapter 28 and verse 13. Curse the whisperer and double-tongued, for such have destroyed many that were at peace. A backbiting tongue have disquieted many and driven them from nation to nation. Strong cities have it pulled down and overthrown houses of great men. A backbiting tongue have cast out virtuous women and deprived them of their labors. Verse 16, whoso hearkeneth unto it shall never find rest and never dwell quietly. Verse 17, the stroke of the whip maketh marks in the flesh, but the stroke of the tongue breaketh the bones.
Those five scriptures in it, that those are heavy scriptures, that cancels out that saying we used to say when we was young, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Many of us was destroyed by the words that was spoke to us while we was young. So pull up that definition of whisper. Pull up that definition of whisperer. We almost done.
Whisperer, one who whispers. A tattler, one who tells secrets. A conveyor of intelligence secretly.
A conveyor of intelligence secretly. One who tells secrets. You always telling somebody business. Every time somebody tell you something, you just can't wait to go tell the next person. That's a whisperer. You always talking about somebody.
Read two again.
A tattler.
Uh-huh. A tattler, I mean, any chance you get, you finna say something about somebody. Read.
One who tells secrets.
Somebody that tell your business.
A conveyor of intelligence secretly.
That intelligence, that's talking about information. A conveyor of information secretly. Like, we got information that we not supposed to let certain people know about. People amongst us do that. They're amongst us, the nation. They're amongst us. That spew out intelligence secretly. They come in here, they spy, and they give out intelligence. Information.
Yeah, read the third one.
Number three, a backbiter, one who slanders secretly.
So a whisperer is one who slanders secretly. Pull up the definition of double tongue. That's the next one, yeah. Double tongue.
Double tongue. Making contrary declarations in the same subject at different times.
So this that brother or sister that they go tell one brother, hey man, you heard, did you see? Let me see. I ain't got no example.
I got one.
You got one.
I read it again, watch this.
Double tongue.
Double tongue. It was a word we should use for that in the world. It was called two-face, I think it was.
Yep.
Watch this, read.
Double-tongued, making contrary declarations on the same subject.
So you're making two different declarations, you're giving two different judgments on the same subject, read.
At different times.
Here's an example. A brother did something out the spirit, right? Got corrected. Everybody seemed to get corrected. Your brother, he was out the spirit, what you did, he was wrong for that. And ain't no explanation behind it. You need to apologize for it openly. Right? That's what you tell a brother. Then, when everybody ain't around, listen. You was right, but I'm just saying next time you just got to move. No, that's double tongue. It's either he getting corrected or he not.
Yeah. All
right?
That's an excellent example. So the next one, pull up the definition of backbite.
Backbite. To censor, slander, reproach, or speak evil of the absent.
This is, I don't have it. Do I have that scripture? I don't have it, but it's a scripture. I think it's in Sirach 19. It says, don't speak of other men's lives. Let's get that. Sirach 19 and 7.
Sirach, or Ecclesiasticus, chapter 19 and verse 7. Rehearse not unto another that which is told unto thee, and thou shalt fare never the worse.
So you don't go and if somebody trusts you enough to confide in you, tell you about something, you don't go and tell nobody else. you don't go and tell. If they come to you and say, hey, how should I handle this? The only time you should be going to tell somebody is you're going up the chain of command, so to say, to get counsel on how to handle it. You shouldn't be going and telling everybody. Now the whole congregation know about something that's out the spirit. That's way out the spirit. It said, rehearse not unto another that which is told unto thee. That's sin. You're gossiping. You're not trying to find a solution. If somebody, let's say a sister or brother, they come vent to you about something, you go to somebody to get counsel to try to help them, that's one thing. But if you just talking their business all over the place, that's out the spirit. That's what this scripture is talking about. You're not trying to get a solution. You're just trying to make them look bad by telling everybody about what they're struggling with. That's what that's going into. Read.
Verse 8.
Yeah.
Whether it be friend or foe.
Whether it's to your friend that you talk to every day, or it's to your foe. Meaning you don't go and tell the enemy what somebody got knowing, so now they got ammo to hate the person more, to do the person wrong more, because now you feed, that's that going into a conveyor of intelligence. Read.
Talk not of other men's lives.
Uh-huh.
And if thou canst without offense, reveal them not.
If thou canst without offense, reveal them not. Meaning, if you ain't got no solution, you need to close your mouth. If you ain't trying to get a solution, close your mouth. Because all you're going to do is create problems. You're going to create division. You're going to create discord. You're going to offend the little ones. Just shut your mouth. Read.
Verse 9. For he heard and observed thee, and when time cometh, he will hate thee.
Meaning this is a person that's waiting for you to tell them your personal information so that they can tell everybody to make you look bad and make themselves look good. Man, you believe he did that? Girl, you believe he did that? They can't wait to hear some information so that they can make themselves look like they on a pedestal and everybody else look like they full of sin. Read.
Verse 10. If thou hast heard a word.
If you heard a word. If somebody told you a secret. Read.
Let it die with thee.
Let it die with you. Don't go telling everybody business about. Don't go telling everybody business. Read.
And be bold.
Be bold. Why?
It will not burst thee.
It will not burst you. Because if you got that spirit where you just yap, 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 yap. When you hear something. It's going to feel like you can't, it's going to feel like a gush of water that you can't hold back. But what this is saying that you can hold back. Just shut your mouth. Don't say nothing. Go home if you got to. Put the phone down if you got to. Turn your phone off for a little bit. You're not going to burst. You're going to be able to hold that word. Just do it. You got to apply the commandment. Go back to Sirach 28. In 13.
Ecclesiastes chapter 28 and verse 13. Curse the whisperer in double tongue.
So it says, curse the whisperer in double tongue. Read.
For such have destroyed many that were at peace.
They have destroyed many that were at peace. You got brothers, sisters that's just, they just trying to get it right. They just here keeping the commandments, trying to build a good name. And then you got a whisperer in a double tongue that's slandering their name. The causing division, telling lies about an individual. And then now that man, that person's reputation is destroyed because if you going around and telling people and they not correcting you, they believe in what you're saying. And now they feel a certain type of way about this brother or this sister because they believe in everything that you're saying, They ain't verifying it. They ain't trying to correct you. They ain't saying, hey, did you speak to that brother? Did you speak to that sister? Are you trying to get a solution? They just listening to it. And all in all, they intaking and not correcting you. Now they hate this person. Now they hate the brother or sister. And haven't even lifted a finger to get to know them. Read on.
For such have destroyed many that were at peace.
Uh-huh.
A backbiting tongue have disquieted many.
Uh-huh.
And driven them from nation to nation.
Read.
Strong cities hath it pulled down and overthrown the houses of great men.
Uh-huh.
A backbiting tongue have cast out virtuous women and deprive them of their labors.
It's that sister that's building, that's just got work. She's doing everything that's required of her. And then because some sister got envy, some sister envious, oh, she thinks she all that. Now she's backbiting, speaking lies, and destroy that virtuous woman that got good works. And now that woman that got good works will end up getting offended and fade back, fade to the black. Read.
Verse 16. Whoso hearkeneth unto it shall never find rest.
If you hearken unto it without correcting, say you never going to find rest because you're going to get the same judgment that the whisperer and the backbiter going to get. Read.
And never dwell quietly.
Your thoughts and your mind, you're going to be tormented. Read.
The stroke of the whip maketh marks in the flesh, but the stroke of the tongue breaketh the bones.
The stroke of our words are very, our words speak to the spirit. That's why I say the stroke of the tongue breaketh the bones, because your tongue can destroy someone's soul, their spirit, crush them.
And that, you know what? That's why the Bible talks about, like, jesting is not even, what did it say?
It's not convenient.
In Ephesians 5 and 4.
Read that real quick. Because sometimes we may think we just joking with somebody, say something. You may think it's funny to yourself or a little joke, but you won't even realize you just destroyed this person's spirit. Their countenance just changed all of a sudden. Read what you got.
Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 4. Neither filthiness nor foolish talking.
Nor what?
Nor foolish talking.
Filthiness and foolish talking. Read.
Nor jesting.
Nor joking around. This is not a place to be joking around. You cracking jokes on fellow officers. You're not even knowing the brother wife standing right there. You know what I mean? You just crushed a man's spirit. Or could have. Read.
Which are not convenient.
It's not convenient. This ain't the time and place for that. Now, officer said something heavy. Go back to where you was at. In verse 17, I think it was, yeah. You got to think about this scripture right here. This is heavy. It said, the stroke of the whip make marks in the flesh. Watch this.
The stroke of the whip maketh marks in the flesh.
So we know if you whip somebody on the skin, on the surface, it's going to leave marks there. Whip, right? Bruise it. Read.
But the stroke of the tongue.
The stroke of the tongue, though. Read.
Breaketh the bones.
You got to imagine. The Most High made man in his image and likeness. He made us gods, right? Right? Before he did that, he spoke everything into existence. So that tongue that you use to speak life, that same tongue you can use to destroy life. Scripture says that. It's a scripture that say that. That's all I got.
Go to Sirach chapter 21 and 25. So we got it. This is another one of them spirits that's rampant in Israel. Israel come in, and this is one of them spirits that be hard for brothers and sisters to get up, to shake up off of them. But as we want to be righteous before God, we got to gird up the loins of our mind and shake this spirit. Read that.
Ecclesiastes chapter 21 and verse 25. The lips of talkers will be telling such things as pertain not unto them.
The lip of talkers, that whisperer, that backbiter, that double tongue, always speaking about stuff that ain't got nothing to do with you. Always got an opinion. Well, I heard that the brother got judged and it was a wrongful judgment. Always talking to things that have nothing to do with you. You don't know nothing about. You don't know what's going on
That's
with
heavy.
It.
Because you said earlier, it ain't just women, is it?
It ain't just women.
It ain't just women. That's... You got grown-ass men that be doing that. Grown as hell. That's crazy, man. Wait.
Why he get raised up and I ain't get raised up? The lip of talkers is talking. Read on.
But the words of such as have understanding are weighty.
Those that have understanding, read it again.
But the words of such as have understanding are weighty in the balance.
It says the words of such as have understanding are weighed in the balance. What's the balance? before you speak, you think, is this going to edify my brother? Is this going to provide a solution for my brother or sister? You actually think before you speak. You take heed to the commandment. You exercise discretion. Read.
Is it going to hurt him or is it going to help him?
Right.
You got to think like that.
Verse 26. The heart of fools is in their mouth.
The heart of fools is in their mouth. The heart of a fool, everything you tell them, it's coming right out. They ain't going to keep nothing in their mind. Everything that come to their mind, they going to say. That's where that coarse jesting come from, where you overstep your boundaries with things. Yep. You everything that come to your mouth, you going to say it. That's not wise. You got to think about what you say, because your words, not only can they hurt the person you talk to, your words can get you in trouble. You're gonna think something and say something in the wrong place at the wrong time and mess around and get judged.
Hey, it's a scripture, it's a rock that say that, but it goes into how, like, you had too much access to drink, and you get to talking crazy, and you wake up with a well-whooped ass. scripture say that.
Read on.
Verse 27, when the ungodly...
Read 26 again.
The heart of fools is in their mouth.
So the heart of a fool is going to speak everything that comes to their mind. Read.
But the mouth of the wise is in their heart.
The mouth of the wise is going to think before they speak. The mouth of the wise is going to think, you know what, is this the right time for me to say this? Should I be saying this? Is this the right thing to say? Is this the right tone to say it in? The wise man is going to always be thinking about, what should I say? How should I say it? What tone should I say? Read.
Verse 27. When the ungodly curse of Satan, he curseth his own soul.
Hey, this is a heavy scripture. You have Israel come in here and give all the shaloms, the salutes, and then the bishop class come on and they bring it out. Let's say they bringing out something on Esau. And you had that same person that got the devil on them. That's the whisperer, the gospel, the liar, the stealer. And they curse Satan and don't realize you doing the same thing that Esau do. You lying and stealing and gossiping against your own brother, against your own people. And you doing it in secret, but you cursing Satan, you cursing your own soul because you rolling in the spirit of Satan. Read.
Verse 28, a whisperer defileth his own soul and is hated wheresoever he dwelleth.
When you got that spirit, you just always talking about somebody, about the person that you're talking to, not to him, but you're talking to somebody else about him. And then you go and talk to this other person. You talk about everybody. Don't nobody want to be around you. Every time you come in the room, you come and sit in the circle gone. Because don't nobody want to be around a person like that. Go to Sirach 5 and 13. We almost done. I didn't expect to go this long.
Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 13. Honor and shame is in talk.
Honor and shame is in talk. You either going to be honorable by the words that you speak, or you're going to be shameful by the words that you speak. Read.
And the tongue of man is his fall.
The tongue of man is his fall. And we're not talking about a slip of the tongue, because a slip of the tongue going to happen occasionally. Occasionally, you're going to slip of the tongue. Occasionally, you're going to speak a little too rash. But when you get corrected, you're going to be like, you know what? That was a little rash. You're going to accept the correction, and you're going to correct yourself. But it says, the tongue of man is his fall. That's that person that don't care about how they say, what they say, when they say. They don't care. And that's going to be your fall, because ain't nobody going to want to be around you. You're going to have no friends, so to say, because ain't nobody going to want to be around you. Because when you get correct, when you told, hey, man, you got a contentious spirit. Hey, sis, you got a contentious spirit. Why are you always getting on the defensive when I say something to you? Man, what you mean? I ain't contentious. I just got to speak my piece. Ain't nobody going to want to deal with you. Read.
Verse 14, be not called a whisperer and lie not in wait with thy tongue.
Don't be called a whisperer and don't lie in wait with your tongue, meaning you waiting. Lie in wait with your tongue, meaning you're fishing for information so you can go and tell it to the world. You're not just talking to somebody. You're not just talking to somebody and it's a casual conversation and they confide in you. No, you're actually prying, trying to get the information so that you can go and tell. That's what that's going into read.
For a foul shame is upon the thief.
A foul shame is upon the thief. Read.
And an evil condemnation upon the double tongue.
And notice, just like we read Leviticus 19:11, lying and stealing go hand in hand. And then it go hand in hand with a gossiper. Because when you gossip, you lie. Not only are you lying, you trying to steal the fame of another person. And you're trying to steal the fame of another person that they worked, certain person that worked for the fame. Not saying they self-proclaimed fame. They put in work, so they got a good name. So you're trying to steal that good name that they have by slandering their name. And then be double-tongued to try to make yourself look good. Go to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 22. This is the spirit that we, in this truth, if we're going to be righteous before God, this is what we must do. Ephesians chapter 4 and 22.
Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22. That ye put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust.
That lying spirit, that stealing spirit, that gossiping spirit, that's the old man. We supposed to be building ourselves up to be like Christ. That's the old man. We got to put it off. Read. And it says, put off the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt. If we continue in a corrupt spirit, we're going to be put to death. We wasting our time, man. You might as well go back on the corner, go back to the Christian church, go back to do that stuff. Know what you're wasting your time for if you're not going to correct your actions. Read.
Verse 23. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind.
We got to be renewed in the spirit of our mind. The only way we're going to do that is by meditating on these scriptures and applying it. And I say that together because you got to meditate on the scriptures and apply. Ain't no sense of you knowing all the precepts. Every time somebody asks for something, you know what, you got it. You know what, but then you ain't applying nothing. You have to meditate on it. That's how you renewed in the spirit of your mind. By learning and applying. Read.
Verse 24. And that ye put on the new man.
Put on the new man. Put on the commandments. Read.
Which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness.
Because when we put on the commandments after God, we created in righteousness and true holiness. We're going to walk in that right spirit because we actually walking in sincerity and keeping these commandments.
We used to scream black power while Heron was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission. Minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold, from Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone, 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are how our men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.